All right, everyone, welcome to the video. And what we're going to do here is I'm going to go through this book, Spaciousness, the Radical Exhaustion of the Vajra Heart, translated by Keith Dauman. And I'm going to do a little bit of transposing as I go along. Now, having a past history of being a musician, although I'm not a musician anymore, I'm a spiritual musician, you might say, transposing is something where you shift keys, and being able to do that on the fly is the mark of a real professional musician. What we do here is there's some terminology in this book, Tibetan Buddhist terminology and various terms, that might feel a little sticky to people, and they say, can you give me a little help here? Could you put it in the key that I can sing in? And so, I don't have any trouble with any of these words. It really, I maybe a little bit like the term spontaneity. What does that mean? But this is a translation by Keith Dauman, a really very great translation. But we're using words here, so you had to choose, well, which word do I use to try to convey something? And it's up to, you know, each one of us what kind of labels we apply. And they're inexact at best, really. It's the essence that needs to come through. So I will try to do some transcribing a little bit for us here on the fly and see how it goes. I haven't done this before, but why not? So Longchenpa, who is an emanation of Manjushri, which is a term used to apply to a bodhisattva, is one of the top, if not the top bodhisattva. What is that? It's a kind of emanation from our natural mind, the mind of totality, which is the only mind there is, of compassion, clarity, wisdom, and mercy, to awaken those spirits that are seeking for, whimsically seeking for a lie that is true, really an absence of totality, and have a continuity fear. They're afraid to awaken. They feel awakening is annihilation or an abyss, the annihilation of an abyss, which it isn't. So this action of compassion is what we call bodhisattvaism. The Buddhism calls it that. I think Hinduism may refer to that in some ways, in various. But it is just the activity, pragmatic activity. Christians call it the Holy Spirit, and the angels, that sort of thing. Okay. Buddha mind in Buddhism might be a way of referring to the Holy Spirit of Christianity, in that it's this Buddha mind refers to natural mind, the mind of totality, total awareness, which is the only mind and awareness there is, actually, in its capacity of helping us. Okay, just so Christianity, the Holy Spirit is the grace of God, the grace of totality, helping us. It's the same basic principle. And so this bodhisattva we call Manjushri is this wonderful pragmatic action of clarity and wisdom, helping us out. And this bodhisattva appeared in Tibet as what we call Longchenpa, this great teacher who taught what we call now Dzogchen. Which is a very advanced teaching, and it's right direct to the point. Manjushri, the characteristic is right to the point, very direct, very right to the point, very clear. Okay, now, I happen to like this, I really do. Extraordinarily helpful. So this sort of teaching is not sort of gradualism. It is saying, look, this is the truth. Focus on what the truth really is. And get familiar with it, because familiarity is what wins. Because what we have is a continuity problem. It's the only problem we have. And the only way to turn the tide of our continuity fear is through familiarity. It's the only way. Because continuity fear is really just a feeling of lack of familiarity with reality, with totality. Because we have been searching for an absence of totality and plausibly inferring that it exists for so long, that this is what we're familiar with. So we have this trepidation, like a continuity fear, like, oh, I don't want to be catapulted into totality. I will annihilate my identity, my searching identity. We believe the search is some sort of identity, and we're identifying with this search. And without the search, we feel we wouldn't have any identity at all. Well, we'd have the one identity of totality. We certainly would. But anyway, so Longchenpa was this great, very great teacher, and he wrote this down. And it starts out with a prologue. It says, "Homage to glorious Kuntuzangpo and Sri Samantabhadra." These are just terms, okay, that refer to the all-good Buddha. And he goes on to say, "Homage to the all-good Buddha," which is natural mind, totality. "Homage to the glorious totality." And this is just labels anthropomorphizing to a certain extent to step it down for us so we feel we can relate to it a little better. "Homage to pristine spontaneity." Okay, spontaneity. This is a term that's used throughout this book. And it's a very key focus here. Very key focus. And what is being referred to here as spontaneity? Well, what it means is that everything that arises directly from our desire to have it arise, and there's no other causation of it whatsoever. It arises directly from totality as an expression of totality without diminishing totality at all. It's just a direct, there's no other cause. It's immediate and uncaused other than by the nature of reality. So there's nothing intervening. There's nothing that intervenes in our experiencing. It's all totality always. Nothing intervening. So the term spontaneity, it's all spontaneous. Nothing is getting in the way. There's no obstructions at all. Everything arises in an unobstructed manner. Something along these lines. But it's this very abstract term that, you know, when we apply any term at all to reality, it seems less abstract than it really is. And so you have to use some term here. And this is the one that Keith Dauman chose to use. But he says that, well, I could have used other terms, but I just, you know, chose to use this one. So, homage to pristine spontaneity. So what Longchenpa does is he sort of keeps reinforcing in many different ways the what he's pointing at, what he's getting, you know, what he wants us to recognize and get familiar with. Pristine spontaneity. It's not just spontaneity, pristine spontaneity. It's so none of the terms are it. Okay, none of these terms are it. This is what we need to realize. Everything that he says here, it's not it. But it's got the flavor. It seems that, you know, it sort of infers, it plausibly infers the flavor. But ultimately, the tasting, we have to do the tasting. All that any teacher can do is infer the flavor. Plausibly infer it to us, the scent. Plausibly infer the scent of it. So this is what Longchenpa Manjushri Longchenpa is doing, is this reinforcing of plausible inference. And this is the most that we can do in terms of helping one another out. But ultimately, we have to decide to taste and see, right? Have to taste it. So we start out again with this prologue. We say, "Homage to glorious Kuntuzangpo, Sri Samantabhadra. Homage to the all-good Buddha. Homage to pristine spontaneity, the clear light of luminous mind, the amazing reality of this fantastic universe, a treasury of self-sprung awareness in the now, and the source of everything, samsara and nirvana." Samsara and nirvana, easy way to view this is to say that samsara is the seeking for the absence of totality, and nirvana is the not seeking for an absence of totality. So it's seeking and non-seeking, and yet nirvana is still not the ultimate, which Longchenpa points out. The source of everything is what he's pointing out, both the source of everything, samsara and nirvana, both seeking and non-seeking. So he wants to point this out. It's the source of everything, both the seeking, which is delusion, and non-delusion, non-seeking. It's equally the source of all. This is what he's getting at. Okay. "Homage to that motionless space of simplicity. This matrix of the apex approach, the very top approach, the peak orbited by sun and moon, this matrix, and the term matrix is sort of a modern term that's being used just to make us feel comfortable. The overall totality, this matrix, the totality, this matrix of the Vajra heart, Vajra means diamond. So this is a symbol for this shining clarity. This matrix of the Vajra heart, the clear light of spontaneity, this matrix is naturally disposed without effort or practice. Listen while I describe this awesome investiture of the now. Now, we can get everything he's going to say in this prologue. He's telling you, this is what I'm going to talk with, you know, to you about. I'm going to listen while I describe this awesome investiture of the now. So if we really, the more familiar we get, like just reading this prologue, I'm just saying, wow, okay, I don't need any more. That's it. That's right there. All that he does is he stresses over and over. He just stresses this. Like a piano piece with all sorts of variations upon a theme. So he says, this is the theme that I'm going to play, like a spiritual pianist. And then he does these variations upon that theme. That's it. So what I want to do is I want to demystify it, not intellectualize it, but demystify it. Is they think, oh, we're listening to something very esoteric and very mysterious and shrouded in the, you know, Tibetan lore and all this. No, we're not. Actually, we're listening to the simple, clear truth right here and now. From the Holy Spirit, from the Bodhisattva Manjushri, from the Buddha mind, from Longchenpa, from that which clarifies and helps us out, which is here right now. For us, this is very important. We're bringing this into right here, right now. All right, we're not trying to distance ourselves from it in any way. So, we can certainly be benefited from this just as much as any monks, that the renunciates and Dharma followers in Tibetan Buddhism, if they would have gone to Longchenpa, he would have said this to them. We can benefit just the same here, right now. This is something that I absolutely, very strongly see and recognize. In no way are we somehow distant from this, are deficient in any way in our understanding of this. We can put it in very plain, direct, clear language right here, right now, and again be just as benefited from it as any Dharma seekers in back then in the 14th century or any century in Tibet or in India or China or Sri Lanka or Cambodia or India or anywhere at all. Okay. We can benefit just as much as in the Holy Land, you name it, okay, Japan, anywhere. Right here, right now, we can benefit just as much as anyone has ever benefited from this teaching, okay? Everything arises in the vast matrix of spontaneity. And spontaneity is the ground of everything. But empty in essence, never crystallizing. The ground is nothing, although it appears as everything. Samsara and nirvana arise as spontaneity in the Trikaya matrix, which means threefold totality, Trikaya matrix, three-bodied matrix. This is just a convention that is used in Tibetan Buddhism. Yet they can never stir from their intrinsic spaciousness. Samsara Nirvana is talking about. Yet they can never stir from their intrinsic spaciousness, for such are the blissful fields of reality. The nature of mind is an unchanging sky-like supermatrix. a matrix of variable display, compassionate magical emanation. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. It is the creativity of luminous mind pulsating outward and inward, being nothing at all, yet appearing as everything whatsoever. And it paints magnificent, amazing, magical emanation. And the term magical here is not what we think of as magic so much. It's he will go on to clarify all this. Outside and inside, and the material and spiritual dimensions, are ornaments of spaciousness arising as the wheel of sublime form. All sounds and speech, everything that vibrates, are ornaments of spaciousness arising in essence as sublime vibration. All movement of thought and all inconceivable non-thought are ornaments of spaciousness arising as the wheel of sublime mind. The six kinds of mythic beings, moreover, with four types of rebirth, can never stray an iota from the spaciousness of their reality. And the six fields of dualistic sense perception of the universe, appearing in their own spaciousness, like magical illusion, do not truly exist. Baseless, vividly apparent, yet empty in the now, supremely spacious. With natural clarity, they appear as decoration of their intrinsic spaciousness. Wow. And what's he talking about here? The six types of mythic beings, four types of birth, and this. The Buddhists like to categorize and make these lists, and there's six types of this and 20 types of this and so and 1,000 pure lands, and they like to number and list and categorize and such, which is fine, but it's sort of we really don't need to focus on any of that categorizing at all. That's not really the gist of it at all. But it's a convention in speaking to Buddhists. Yudo Longchenpa would use these various conventions. He was addressing a certain tradition as well as going beyond that and saying, look, it's beyond that. Okay, it's beyond the religious tradition here. So it shouldn't bother us or cause us any trouble whatsoever, this various references to certain, you know, six mythic beings, and he says, look, it's whatever beings arise, it could be subtle beings, gods and goddesses. The various traditions talk about these different dimensional beings, etc. But he's talking about that they appear as decoration of their intrinsic spaciousness. They're empty in the now, supremely spacious. So they too are just mere decorations of their own intrinsic spaciousness. All is just a decoration of their own. Everything is just a decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. This is a wonderful way of looking at all appearance as merely a decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. Without any exception whatsoever. So, no matter, here he goes on, no matter what the perception arising in this vast spaciousness, in its unremitting sameness, it is the Dharmakaya of the luminous mind. Kaya means body. Dharma means true awareness, true being. It's like Buddha. It's really very similar. Talk about the same thing. Dharmakaya, I mean the truth body, awareness body. In its unremitting sameness is the truth body, the awareness body of luminous mind. So he's talking about appearances. In other words, all appearances are like the Dharmakaya of luminous mind. And previously said that it's just a decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. It's a decoration. So everything, all appearances are the Dharmakaya of luminous mind, the decoration of luminous mind, our pure spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness, decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. In its unremitting sameness is the Dharmakaya of luminous mind. Disposed in the now, he's talking about perception, no matter what perception, disposed in the now, empty in itself. Empty in itself. It has no self-nature, some separate self-nature. It's empty of self-nature. Your Buddhists talk about emptiness, and they're talking about this. They recognize everything is empty in itself without separate self-nature. Okay, it doesn't have that. Disposed in the now, empty in itself, unchanging, unsublimating. Meaning sublimating is not, it's not taking one thing and changing it into something else. There's no process taking place of changing the emptiness into some non-emptiness. As self-sprung awareness in the now, reality itself, effortlessly, passively, is a part of the one blissful matrix. And so he's speaking of reality itself. He's speaking to our perceptions, what we're perceiving, all these ornamentations. Effortlessly, passively, it is part of the one blissful matrix. That's what it is. In its unchanging intrinsic clarity, it is Sambhogakaya. And there we get into the Trikaya, the three-bodied. There's just these slight differentiations which Buddhists like to make. Longchenpa goes on to say that, look, they're all the same, really. But he's addressing, okay, in its quality, in its unchanging intrinsic clarity, it is Sambhogakaya, which means the enjoyment body. And however it manifests, it is spontaneity. Uncontrived and unalloyed in its unremitting sameness. Whatever the shape of the distinct multifarious display, its reality is self-sprung emanation, magical projection, and it never strays from the non-action of the all-good. In the fail-safe luminous mind, the unfabricated Trikaya, threefold body, is already perfected. Not stirring from spaciousness, its spontaneity uncompromised, the activity of Buddha in Buddha fields is already perfected. So Buddha, you know, totality, in Buddha fields, emanations and appearances in this totality. It's already perfected. The matrix of sublime spontaneity dawns in the now. Universal multiplicious diversity perfected in the now. This field of unalterable, unsublimating spontaneity in the now, this is the visible reality of intrinsic spaciousness. Non-crystallizing knowledge arising to ornament that spaciousness. Already arrived, nothing to do, without any practice, like the sun in the sky. That is an amazing, superb reality. Here in this womb-like spaciousness, in the spontaneity of the now, samsara is all good, in other words, seeking for absence is all good. And while nirvana is also all good, not seeking for absence is all good. In this all good matrix, in the now, neither samsara nor nirvana exist. Appearances are all good, and while emptiness is also all good, in this all good matrix, in the now, neither appearance nor emptiness exist. Life is all good, and while good and bad feelings are also all good, in this all good matrix, neither life nor feelings exist. Self and other are both all good, and while acceptance and rejection are also all good. In this all good matrix, no self and other, no affirmation or negation is possible. In delusion, we reify or concretize an abstract, something abstract, we concretize it. In delusion, we reify what is not truly existent and label it. Why is it that we so readily affix attributes to samsara and nirvana when their nature is so dreamlike, baseless, and evanescent? Everything is all good, magnificent spontaneity, and delusion, never having existed in the past, existing neither in the present nor the future. Quote, life, unquote, is just a label, the paradox of being and non-being resolved. No one has ever been deluded anywhere in the past. No one is deluded now, and no one will be deluded in the future. That is alpha pure vision of past, present, and future. Alpha meaning just, you know, the absolute top. Alpha pure, just emphasizing, alpha pure vision of past, present, and future. When delusion is non-existent, non-delusion cannot arise. And spontaneously in the now, pure presence is right here. Since there never was release, is no release now, and never will be, quote, nirvana, unquote, is a mere label, and no one has ever known liberation. There can be no release because no confinement can exist in the now. And pure like the sky, nothing can ever be restricted or localized. That is alpha pure vision of ultimate liberation. In short, in the spontaneity of this vast womb-like spaciousness, what seems to be samsara or nirvana is a display of creativity that at its very inception is neither samsara nor nirvana. Further, no matter what dream arises in the creativity of sleep, it is, in truth, an absence, a blissful rest in natural presence. Smoothly spaced out in vast, unremitting sameness. So this term absence is being used in referring to the dream in creativity of sleep. It's referring to that. It is in truth an absence, a blissful rest. We're actually just blissfully resting in natural presence, smoothly spaced out in vast, unremitting sameness. It's not an absence of totality. It's an absence, you might say, of absence. As we're dreaming of absence, is really what it is an absence of absence. The dream of absence is what it really is smoothly resting in natural presence in this smoothed out sameness. of intrinsic spaciousness. So, Nirvana, he's using this term as like liberation from seeking. So we have seeking, which is samsara, seeking for an absence of totality, and then Nirvana is the concept of liberation from this. What Longchenpa Manjushri is getting at here is that true liberation is awakening to no arriving, no release in the now, no arriving in the now. It's not that we say, "Oh, I was in the absence of totality, but I finally arrived back home in the totality." It's the recognition, acceptance that even in the dream of this absence of totality, it was we were always resting in the smoothed out oneness. We never left it. It's impossible to leave it. So there cannot be any nirvanic triumph. This is what Buddha discovered in his trance states. When he went through all these meditative trance states, he said, that's not it. You can go into all these nirvanic states where you're fixated on one something. So you're not searching. You're just fixated on some object of fixation. This is a trance state, actually. But this is not genuine liberation. It can bring about a certain amount of peace of mind, and yet that peace of mind is dependent on maintaining this fixation, the trance state, and all sorts of stuff intervenes so it's effort-based. Whereas what Longchenpa is getting at is this is not effort-based. Let's go to the second last paragraph. When delusion is non-existent, non-delusion cannot exist. So in other words, when samsara, delusion, is not, samsara refers again to delusion, which is the seeking for absence of totality. When delusion, or samsara, is non-existent, non-delusion, which is nirvana, liberation from seeking, cannot exist. And spontaneously in the now, pure presence is right here. Since there never was release, or nirvana, release, is no release now, and never will be, quote, nirvana, quote unquote, is a mere label, and no one has ever known liberation. So this is at the heart, you see, of Buddha's teaching, and and grace-filled teaching. Ultimately, all teaching is pointing towards this. No one has ever known liberation. There can be no release because no confinement can exist in the now. So we've never been confined. Confinement has never existed. So how can we be released from confinement? That's dualism. That leads to dualistic religious spiritual teachings, which is what we've been trapped in. And pure like the sky, nothing can ever be restricted or localized. That is alpha pure vision of ultimate liberation. Alpha pure vision of ultimate liberation, which is the only, well, he used the term liberation, of ultimate liberation, is liberation from the notion of liberation. And this doesn't mean we're trapped. It means there is no confinement to be liberated from. We're trapped only because we're trying to liberate ourselves, which presupposes a confinement. But alpha pure ultimate liberation is the realization there's nothing that can ever be confined or localized or restricted at all. Everything is just the intrinsic ornamentation of pure spaciousness. It's ornamentation of. Let us go back to what he says here. Samsara and nirvana arise as spontaneity in the threefold matrix, yet they can never stir from their intrinsic spaciousness, for such are the blissful fields of reality. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Okay. With natural clarity, everything arises. With natural clarity, they appear as decoration of their intrinsic spaciousness. So everything that is arising, whether it's seeking or non-seeking, liberation or non-liberation, is really just empty of anything other than just an ornamentation of their own intrinsic spaciousness. Everything is an ornamentation of its own intrinsic spaciousness, of just the one pure intrinsic spaciousness that is. So we're looking to shift our perspective to this perspective. And we're looking to get familiar with this. And to recognize, this is all that's been pointed out. We have this thing about ancient religions and teachings and even modern ones and the esoteric this and this and that. It gets so complicated as they're labeling, categorizing, and such and such and such and such. This is taking us, freeing us, liberating us from all of that, liberating us from liberation. Because since liberation doesn't really work, it ends up categorizing and labeling so much to make it seem like it's working. And it says, well, I can see this, and I see this, and this, and this, and this, and this. And it gives this illusion of success. So the simplicity of this message has been given out throughout history in many different places. And those that, when it's given out, tend to still, they're trapped in this notion of samsara nirvana, of seeking a liberation from seeking, of presumed absence, and then liberation from presumed absence. And so they begin to try and label and categorize, and produce these various religious movements of labeling and categorizing. Whereas the true message is this very simple, direct message. So what we are avoiding here is to produce a religion out of this, okay? That's not the purpose. For instance, A Course in Miracles, Jesus points out very clearly, the purpose of this is not to start another religion. Absolutely not. It's to liberate us from all religions, all categorizing and all labeling, all samsara and nirvana, all seeking and all apparent liberation from seeking, by recognizing that we never strayed one iota from simply decoration of our own intrinsic spaciousness. Because the liberation is liberation from something that we think we need to be liberated from. This is a very tricky trap. But we can say liberation from continuity fear, pragmatically, is a liberation. It's maybe the only liberation there is, you might say. And so it's not a liberation from something bad, you know, that's out there or something. It's just a continuity fear of a lack of familiarity. And it's only temporary. So it might say a temporary liberation, so to speak. Which leads to the recognition that there never was anything that we needed to be liberated from. So really this whole search and trouble we're in is the belief that we need to be liberated from something. There's something, what? We need to be liberated from totality. That's all there is. So we had the whimsical idea we needed to be liberated from totality. There's something greater than totality. And there is not. So alpha pure ultimate liberation is differentiated from the conventional liberation of nirvana, of trance state. Now, many throughout the ages have tried these various trance states and gotten into samadhi of this and this trance state and that trance state. But what we're finding out now is that that is not alpha pure ultimate liberation. And it does have a subtle curiosity about delay. And therefore, it does open the door to smartness and how to streamline the search for absence of totality. And it doesn't carry the same conviction as all of alpha pure ultimate liberation. So you have those who maybe have experienced samadhi, unmoving mind, and that relative peacefulness through effort. But this is not the goal, really. And it doesn't carry the same weight as someone who's in this alpha pure ultimate liberation of recognizing that everything inherently is always, can I never stray from merely being decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. Samsara and Nirvana are both decoration of their intrinsic spaciousness, equally so. Everything is. There's all sameness. Sameness, 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 sameness. You might say it's the vision of sameness. Jesus calls it the vision of Christ. Christ means an oil, an anointing, anointed with oil. And what is oil? It has same. The surface characteristics of oil are smoothness, sameness, right? You put oil on something, it's symbolizing spiritual illumination, recognition, Buddha mind, recognition, Christ mind. Christ mind means vision of sameness mind, which is Buddha mind, same thing. Christ mind, Buddha mind are really exactly the same. It's just a different label referring to exactly the same totality, the smoothed out spaciousness, smoothed outness of pure spaciousness, the sameness, vision of sameness. Vision of oneness. It's all referring to exactly the same experiencing of totality, experiencing totality. Everything is spontaneously, without any effort on its part, is just an intrinsic decoration, a decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. Just a decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness, and seeing everything like this, the sameness of it all is vision of Christ, vision of sameness, vision of oneness, vision of totality, like that. All sorts of labels have been applied to throughout history. It's all the same. So what we're doing is we're demystifying all of this. Because the message, the real message, has always been very simple. It's we that have mystified it throughout history. And we need to get away from all this mystification. Today, this morning, it was very clear. I said, oh, it's a nice day. And then all this mist came in. I said, oh, you know, this is the world, right? We get the simple truth and then we mystify it. We mystify ourselves. We mystify truth. And then seek within that mystification. Mist, to miss, to miss, mystify, to be mystified, to be full with this mist, and not really sure where I am, not really sure. You know, it clouds over the categorizing and labeling, all that cloud over the truth, right? The sky-like nature of mind. The sky-like nature of mind. Longchenpa Manjushri emphasizes this. Sky-like nature of mind, no mystification, sky-like nature of mind, equally disposed in all directions, equally disposed in all directions, smoothed out smoothness in all directions. Trouble comes when we try to put this into the mystification, the simplicity. Say, well, the past must have understood it, and all this mystification, we need to somehow relate it to the mystification as if it's a byproduct of it somehow. No. The mystification was missing the mark. The mystification was missing the mark. It was the struggle. It was the struggle with this. It was the struggle. And we struggle in many different ways. some of them esoteric ways. Some of them have bells and whistles and lights and buzzings and, you know, all sorts of various situations arise in seeking and mystifying and trance days, etc. But we need not have any of those. That doesn't mean anything, really. It's not important. I've had a notable absence of all of that. Very notable absence of all of that in my life. Not interested in trance states and what you can experience in trance states. Nor even going through them and saying, oh wow, okay, wow, I'm in this trance state. Yeah, there's just bypass all that. It's not, everything is just decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. Everything is just decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. All that arises inherently is that from the very beginning, is spontaneously that. Meaning there's no effort required to be that. Spontaneously that. Spontaneously that. Sri Nisargadatta Maharaja's, well, it's not his book, it was the book that was written about him. I am that. Might be said, I am spontaneously that. I am spontaneously that. I am that, that. I am spontaneously that. So there's no effort required for everything to be what it is. Decorations of, mere decorations of its own intrinsic spaciousness. There's no effort taking place at all to be that. All effort is itself also just decorations of its own intrinsic spaciousness. It's all the same, 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 all the same. Now what I want to point out here is that this, you're reading, oh, this book from the 14th century, great, you know, Bodhisattva, Longchenpa, and we're supposed to be in awe and distance from it. And what I want to point out is not at all. It's just the opposite. There's no distancing. I don't feel any distancing at all. I don't feel in awe at all. I feel the transmission is very clear, very simple. I'm not even a Buddhist. I don't even have that tradition. Right? It doesn't bother me the slightest bit. I'm not. That doesn't hinder me in the slightest bit. Because all that is mere label. So everything, including all label, is merely, arises as spontaneous decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. And we gotta understand that right here, right now. This is so key. We need to liberate ourselves from the notion that somehow we're buried under this mystification and have to go at it through that. No, we don't. We don't have to go at it through any tradition, actually. Because everything that has ever arisen or ever will is same, 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 same. So there's no need to differentiate between past and future in this way as far as sameness. It's all. It's always the same. Everything is arises as spontaneously and intrinsically, without any effort. Spontaneous without any effort is just merely decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness, and it's nothing more or less than that. And since this is always the same, what antidotes do we need about the past or the future, or what referencing do we need to understand this? So we don't need the past or future to understand this right now. Nobody does. Never will. Never will. So the idea that there has to be some tradition, that some effort has to be made for the simplicity of truth to be heard right now, is not true. It's not true. It only revolves around the continuity problem. That's it. And in that context, of course, right effort is necessary. But it's never necessary for a past or future in terms of psychological time, thinking that, well, I didn't get something from the past and that's needed. I need something from the future to understand this. No, this is all understandable right now. This is all true right now. This is all approachable right now. Now, we may take time to evaporate our continuity fear, but it's all approachable right now. Absolutely it is. It doesn't matter where we think we are, or where we think we've been, or where we think we're going. Truth is approachable right here, right now. And by approachable, of course, I'm not speaking in a theoretical context of, but I mean just a pragmatic context. There's two contexts of speaking, the pure abstract and then the pragmatic. And so we don't confuse these two, all right? To do so is called level confusion. And this is one of the troubles that those who are mystified, they cling to level confusion, but because it's a nice defense. They say, well, I can't differentiate between the abstract and the pragmatic. Yeah. Well, of course we can. But continuity fear uses that as one of its big defenses. It says, well, so there's no approach to liberation because everything already is what it is. So how can you say that we need to approach it? Remember, pragmatically, we have a continuity fear. So the approach to evaporating our continuity fear is that we can, quote unquote, approach the now. The now is approachable right now. The now is recognizable, accepting. We can accept it right now. We can try to accept it right now, which we use the term approach. We can try to accept it right now. We can try to accept it right now and thus experience continuity fear and then work on evaporating that continuity fear. Recognize, oh, I have some resistance to it. So there's nothing we need to do first to try to approach it right now. And then recognize our failure is based on what? Continuity fear. So as long as we recognize that continuity fear is temporary, pragmatism is thus temporary, we won't confuse the temporary with the eternal. In terms of temporary meaning, we ultimately will recognize there was never any necessity to search for absence of totality. There wasn't any necessity. We wrongly believe that our search is something that got the totality mandated, that we must search for something greater than totality, therefore we must view totality as an absence of the greater totality. Okay, this is how we have been perceiving. This is what's based on, our troubles are based on, is we had this whimsical idea we wanted to be greater than totality, greater than God, and therefore we viewed totality, the purpose of totality must be an absence of the greater totality. And therefore, the way we use totality is to try to search out the greater totality by trying to recognize the absence of this greater totality within totality. That is, okay? Now let's just let this sink in. It's very profound, actually. It's hitting me that way. And so we're misperceiving the totality. We're giving it a purpose it doesn't have. So of course we do have to drop this purpose. There's no question about it. We do have to drop whimsicality. But it's not through entering a trance state that we drop whimsicality. That's trying to make a home within whimsicality, actually. And so we probably, a lot of us have been there and done that. I'm sure I have at some previous life, gone through trance states and meditative states and trying to, make a house a home. This, and doesn't work. You end up being reincarnated again. It's like, wow. And you try to decorate this home, like for beautiful music, which I tried doing. Again, I found myself back here. So I tried to try out the trance states, first try out clarity of labels and categorizing this, and be really great at categorizing everything. And then you try out trance states, and then you try out maybe, high aesthetic decorations and stuff. And none of that works, and then ultimately you come to the truth, and you meet the great teachers who of who are simplicity, who point out the truth, and you say, look, approach it. You can approach it right now. Try to make an approach right now. This is all they say. Try to make an approach to truth right here, right now. And then when you feel resistance, realize that's just continuity fear. And so then let's work on evaporating that through familiarity, really. So try to make an approach again, and try to make an approach again. Keep trying to make this quote-unquote approach, which really keep trying to accept the non-necessity of this search, and realize that totality doesn't have any purpose. Totality doesn't have the purpose to be totality. It just is. And it certainly doesn't have the purpose of searching for a greater totality. So we think, well, if we drop this purpose, we won't have any purpose. We don't need a purpose. You might say the purpose of totality is to enjoy totality. But it doesn't really have, that's all that there is. It doesn't hold that as some purpose as opposed to some other purpose. So when there's just reality, there isn't some other purpose. So when we see samsara and nirvana, we think, well, samsara is the purpose of trying to find a greater totality, and nirvana is the purpose of not trying to find a greater totality. But totality really doesn't have any purpose. It just is enjoying totality. That's what it is. That's just natural, spontaneous, uncontrived. Because a purpose implies some sort of direction and some sort of effort, doesn't it? And it implies that there could be another purpose. There's just oneness in totality. So there never was this purpose of totality that we need to be liberated from. It's not like totality had this purpose of wanting to be greater than totality. It's that spirit, which is, you might say, the enjoyer of totality, had a whimsical idea for adventure, which was a whimsical venture. See, spirit is inherently adventurous in its enjoying the totality. Totality enjoying totality is very adventurous, extraordinarily so. And there crept this tiny mad idea of whimsicality of, well, I wonder what kind of adventure it would be like if we ascribed a purpose to totality, if totality ascribed a purpose to totality of finding a greater totality. But this is just a whim. It's not really a purpose of totality. It's an idea. Spirit has ideas of adventure in totality. So pure spaciousness does not have the idea of being greater than pure spaciousness. However, that idea can arise in pure spaciousness. All ideas can arise in pure spaciousness, but it doesn't give that purpose to pure spaciousness. So spirit is the one that plays with ideas and experiences the adventure of these ideas, and it's free to be whimsical if it wants to be, but it's also free to not be whimsical. So again, the approach to what we're speaking of, and we're speaking pragmatically here, not practicing. There's a difference between pragmatic conversation here and practicing. In practicing, we would say there's neither approach nor not approach. The approach, non-approach, which is freeing ourselves from all concepts, either approach or non-approach, either samsara or nirvana, that's practicing. But from pragmatic speaking here, the approach to totality, to accepting totality as it is, the purpose-free totality, we can approach that right now. Okay, so this transcends tradition right now. Direct approach, right now, direct approach, unmediated, direct approach right now. And this is what Manjushri specializes in, and it's what I have specialized in my whole life. So it's not any sort of oddity that Manjushri Longchenpa would have shown up in my life and to help out. Specializing in this direct approach right now. And then recognizing what arises from that as failure is really just continuity fear. And then recognizing the effort produces this wow. Wow, I just did it in spite of continuity fear. So this produces a wow. So the direct approach, the effort to make a direct approach, is basically going, you know, it is saying, I'm going to do it even though the continuity fear is causing me fear. I'm still going to make the effort. And then in making the effort, we say, well, I can do it. And it shocks us because we thought continuity fear somehow inherently precluded us from doing this, as if it was an inherency, a necessity of totality to not try and realize that totality has no purpose, to seek a greater totality. We've taken it as some sort of inherency. It's not. And when we actually then make a direct approach, we realize it's just continuity fear. I'm not really blocked or obstructed. I'm not truly obstructed at all. And therefore, this is just evaporatable. I can evaporate this, which means I'm going to succeed. So this produces a wow reaction. So the effort for a direct approach produces a wow reaction, which we can then, we just abide in that wow, full stop in the wow reaction. Now the benefit of this approach is we realize we can always make this direct approach, and therefore we do not get swept away by other approaches, dualistic approaches, smartness, all this stuff, which says first I need to do something first before I make the direct approach, which really is saying that this fear that we know as continuity fear is some sort of inherency, and they're trying to find a smart way to bargain with it, or to actually that's really to make the house a home. Say, look, this is we can't do anything about this, but we can try to make ourselves more comfortable. We get swept away by smartness. We don't get swept away by smartness here. When we make this direct approach, we don't get swept away by smartness. So, and again, when reading this, for instance, reading this this type of verbiage from Longchenpa, we can use the term Manjushri, Buddha mind, etc., to reference totality. Whereas if, for instance, we're reading like from A Course in Miracles or Journey Beyond Words, we could use Holy Spirit, Jesus, as equivalent terms for the totality, that is, the unpurposeful totality. And not seeking a greater totality, no. We gave it. We tried to arrogate the totality, this whim. It doesn't touch totality. Your spaciousness is still naturally disposed in the now, evenly smoothed out, spaced out. All arising and merely ornamentations of its own intrinsic smoothed out spaciousness. So again, this direct approach is like the antidote, the vaccination for smartness. We need to be vaccinated from smartness right now, to tell you the truth. I want to go around vaccinating everybody. Really, we talk about flu vaccination, which I don't get. What we really need to be vaccinated from is from smartness. And may all beings be vaccinated from smartness, absolutely, by attempting this direct approach and then recognizing the resistance as merely continuity fear, no matter how intense it is. And it can be very intense. We still say, this is mere continuity fear, and the reaction I'm really having that I focus on is, wow, I did it. I actually made the attempt right now. Which continuity fear tells us, we can't do it. We can't do it. We can't make it now. We need time. See, continuity fear says, it worships time, it values time, it says, we need time. So I can't do it now, we have to be smart about it. Which really means, let's make ourselves more comfortable before we do it. And of course, smartness always keeps working to make itself more comfortable for it. It never does the direct approach, tries the direct approach. It's an avoidance of the direct approach. Smartness is an avoidance of the direct approach. And of course, the direct approach is really the only approach we can make, which means really it's saying, I'm already here. There isn't any approach that can be made to where I already am. And of course, for the sake of language, it seems that language gets a little awkward there, but we just make a differentiation between pragmatism and abstraction. And so it doesn't bother us at all. We understand that. That there's an awkwardness in language, always will be. And yet we can go beyond words in our experiencing. So, as Jesus puts it, this is a journey beyond words. Journey beyond words. Now, what Longchenpa points out over and over and over is a graduated approach. You know, it doesn't work. It really doesn't work. You're spinning your wheels. Really, this is the graduated approach. It's just smartness. This is what he's referring to, was what I referred to. This is the same reference here. What it's saying is ultimately, no matter how much time you spend on the graduated approach, ultimately you must try to make a direct approach. And then you will experience continuity fear. And you'll say, what the heck? I thought I was ready. I thought I, you know, all this practice I did. And what is this? What is this fear? And then, but it needs to be correctly recognized. Once we correctly recognize this continuity fear, not as intrinsic fear of totality, fear of greater totality, which it is. Okay, once we see it, no, it's just continuity fear, lack of familiarity with totality, then we begin to recognize the wow reaction and start patting ourselves on the back and say, wow, I did it. I really did it. It's great. And you just put a positive spin on the continuity fear and then say, hey, I can evaporate this. I can do this. Then it's not a graduated approach so much. It's different. The terminology is a little different. It's walking together in the wow. It's the wow approach. It's the direct approach. But this still takes, quote-unquote, time, not because we're valuing time, but because it takes a while to evaporate the continuity fear. Like Ramana Maharshi said, you turn off a ceiling fan, it takes a while for that ceiling fan to stop, ultimately. So he says that when you make this direct approach, you may recognize truth for a moment and say, wow, yeah, it's right here, right now. But then you seem to go back to valuing time. But what he says, it takes a while for all these habits that you have to evaporate. It takes a while for continuity fear to evaporate, actually. Because beyond the habits is really the continuity fear. Of like, wow, I don't want to abide in this totality because what'll happen to my identity? Which we've again been identifying with seeking, right? So there's a pragmatic aspect to this. And when we don't confuse, when we correctly label our fear as continuity fear, this level of confusion will evaporate for us rather quickly, actually. This is what I experienced. I used to suffer from level of confusion terribly. And my smartness was trying to resolve this conflict. Hey, okay, I'm going to referee this conflict. But the conflict continued, and the smartness keeps thinking it's some kind of referee. And it was only when I recognized continuity fear for what it was and the wowness for what it is, that's when this then inner conflict of level confusion, it just dried up and vanished. Pretty smoothly, it just evaporated. And I haven't really suffered from it since. Used to suffer from it terribly. So I understand those of us who are suffering from that. It's a horrible thing. We want the truth, but we keep turning to smartness to referee this. We're misidentifying the fear that we have. Misperceiving it. And we're not recognizing the difference between the pragmatic and the practice, theoretical, abstract practice, which is intensely getting used to no conceptuality, neither samsara nor nirvana. We're not making any distinction between either samsara or nirvana. But in a pragmatic talk, it seems as though we're drawing some sort of distinction. And then we may put it always, you know, put it to, well, it's a distinction between samsara and nirvana. Not really. Not really. That's not really the distinction we're making. We're just saying that it, in our valuing of time, it takes a while to evaporate this continuity fear. And so as we're doing that, we use words, and words are inherently awkward because they really have no intrinsic meaning of their own. But when we understand the context in which we're using words, then the awkwardness is very much minimized, very minimized. And then the words are just pointers that we, like shorthand, we say, oh, yeah, okay. Easy to go beyond the words. To practice and to ultimately experiencing. But certainly the precursor to the experiencing we really want is the wow. So the more we just allow this wow to resonate, the closer we get to the experiencing we really want, which is the vision of sameness, vision of oneness. Jesus uses terms of vision of Christ, vision of oneness, vision of sameness. Vision of everything spontaneously arising as mere decoration of its own intrinsic spaciousness. This is another way of putting it. Chilly day today. I'm wearing a lot of layers. How many layers? I'm wearing 4. It's still cold. It's a chilly day. But we're going towards warmer weather. Next week's supposed to be 70 or so. I mean, beautiful high pressure system. So California weather is returning with a wonderful return very soon. So we need to get this vaccination of the direct approach. We need to be vaccinated. We need to have a vaccination program underway, really, in this world. A spiritual vaccination program, so we don't get swept away by smartness. The problem right now with smartness is very severe. The idea of making this house a home, making intrinsic fear, making fear some intrinsic part of our nature, of totality, which really believes that totality is searching for a greater totality, to make that our home, the searching of totality for a greater totality, and try to make it a home, now to try to be comfortable within that context, which is what smartness, that's the purpose it serves. The problem is with this, with all this high-tech stuff that is being employed to produce all these various comforts and material things, and it's really becoming more and more sophisticated at warp speed. We're going to be inundated with this. That's why I stay out of stores right now. Pretty much boycotting stores too. If I order online, boycott the news, boycott stores. You go in there and it's just like your head is spinning with all the new stuff. It's best to boycott stores. And if there's something specific you need, like the Holy Spirit will give me, like, says it'd be good for you if you forget this. So just search for this particular thing, these parameters, and I narrow it down quickly. Oh, there it is. I find it, order it. That's it. I don't go to shopping malls. Boycott shopping malls. Boycott shopping malls. So there should be the list of stuff we're boycotting to help us out. This is also part of the spiritual vaccination program, which is to take the direct approach. Because smartness is saying, look at what this technology, which laser technology guided by, you know, computer technology, sort of the melding, the combination of computers and lasers, and roboticism and all this. I went into a tile store recently. They must have been using lasers to cut all this tile or something. It's extraordinary. All the surface variations and color variations of this tile is just very sophisticated and complex. And it's becoming more so. Every time you go in there, there'll be different stuff, which is even more amazing and complex. Of course, everything inherently spontaneously arising without straying iota from its intrinsic mere decoration, being a mere decoration of its intrinsic spaciousness. That's all that everything is. And however, the sophistication of all this, it makes our head spin. If you go into a tile shop, you know, or, you know, tile and granite, countertop, you know, that kind of those. It's like, you know, wow. And you start getting this craving, like, well, maybe I could put that stuff in my bathroom, in my kitchen, in my floor, and wall, you know, this stuff. Wow. And then maybe I'd be more comfortable. Okay, this is smartness. This is the danger. Artificial intelligence, meaning all this roboticism and convenience of, you know, right? Supposed convenience. You just have a smartphone, just does everything. You swipe, you pay with it, you scan with it, you find it, you search it. You know, this is searching for convenience and comfort. Trying to streamline the search for convenience and comfort. And this is an extreme danger right now for the direct approach, to be misled away from the direct approach, which is really just into delay. You can't really succeed until you make a direct approach. So you can stay on the path of gradualism for a long time, trying to build habits of good moral, be a good pious person. But all that that ultimately leads up to is ultimately realizing you still have to make a direct approach. Meaning right now. Now, I remember my attempts to make direct approaches, my first attempt to get, I was just like having a nervous breakdown almost. Really. I said, I can't do it. Just shaking and trembling. It's just terrible. Like a crisis. And I say, well, I shouldn't have this problem. I've done so much graduated work, I shouldn't have this problem. I shouldn't have a problem. What's the matter? Maybe I'm facing an abyss. You know, it's just all this stuff. And so you delay more, So what we have is an excuse here to delay more. What artificial intelligence, computers and lasers, roboticism, and all this stuff, it gives us an excuse to delay more. A really powerful excuse to delay more. Wow. Very tempting excuse. So over here, for instance, we have a backdrop that is all fragmented, okay, and over here we have a backdrop that is all, you know, smoothed out. This symbolize represents it, represents, I just noticed that. I said, hey, this really represents what we're talking about. And what Lhokchampa says and emphasizes over and over is the graduated approach doesn't really work. And he's calling us to the direct approach, meaning make the effort right now. Make the approach right now. That I'm already there. And we think, well, how did I arrive? What did I do in my graduated approach that worked? Nothing. I didn't do anything that worked. I've always been right here, right now. I've always been just in a... All appearancing has always been just an intrinsic decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. A decoration of intrinsic spaciousness. It's always been that. So there's nothing we did with our graduated effort that made it so. And then we think, well, that's an abyss, an identity abyss. I mean, where's the effort? Where's the smartness? What did I do? No, totality is the one identity. I didn't have some separate identity that realized something greater than the totality. So this is not the new totality. We've been seeking something greater than totality, and we think that success is to find the greater totality. No, there is no greater totality than the one totality that is. So it's not a matter of a successful search in that way. So what I'm doing, I'm just getting familiar with this along with you. We're walking together in the wow here. This is all, for me also, I'm practicing. This is spiritual gym. I'm like a trainer that works out with the people that come, you know, the clients. You know, they're working out at the same time. They're doing the calisthenics. They're doing the stretching. They're doing this and that, flexibility stuff. And they're also benefiting from it. But they have sort of a little bit more of a singular focus, and they don't get knocked off course so easily, and can do class after class after class, so they're in really good shape. Whereas those who come in, they after the one class, they're like, oh, okay, I need to take a rest. So I'm getting what Longchamp is saying better and better and better. What he's getting at I've been at this now for so about 2 years and 3.5 ish plus months, 2 years and 2 months plus working on this, so I can, you know, have a clearer comprehension of this, of what he's getting at, what's being denoted here, what's being pointed out, what the purpose is here. And so over that 2 years and two plus months, there's been a familiarity taking place. So there's a difference between getting familiar with the direct approach and trying to take a gradual approach as if that's what will succeed. So that's a different use of the term gradual. You might say, I gradually have been getting familiar. But that's the right use of the term gradual. You know, this is the correct term in terms of, whereas the graduated approach is really an attempt to avoid the direct approach. All smart is saying, you don't need the direct approach. Because when we make the direct approach, what we find out is that's curtains for smartness. It's over. As soon as we realize we can do it, then it's just a matter of evaporating this continuity fear, and that's it. That's finished for smartness. It's really a knockout blow. It's kind of like you think there's this invincible foe, and suddenly you land a punch, like David on Goliath, and you land this punch, and it knocks down this invincible foe, and you suddenly realize, oh my gosh, you know, they're not invincible. This foe is not invincible at all. It changes, the whole dynamic changes then, the wow arises. So the graduated approach is really trying to avoid this. This is why it keeps dreaming up more and more different approaches, this, label, categorize, or it'll spend lifetime after lifetime after lifetime, think, okay, I need this trance state, that, and that, and that, and that, and that. It's delaying its own demise, kind of, right? I mean, to recognize the non-necessity of this search, it's delaying it. But of course, it knows we want to succeed, so it spiritualizes the delay. So the graduated approaches are really spiritualizing delay. However, Longchamp also points out that ultimately the intent, since the intent really was to succeed, but yet we were being confounded by continuity fear, that all the discipline that we have put forth in spiritualizing delay, all that discipline and all the good habits, etc., those can be turned around and put to good use in the direct approach with the discipline and the patience and the determination. Ultimately, the good habits can be put to good use, but we have to give them a different orientation, different context for sure. It has to be the direct approach context. So if I happen to be blessed in some way to help out with the spiritual vaccination program, which I think I will, I already have been, so to speak, it's because of this sort of contextual familiarity that I've gained, and it's part of my beingness, so to speak, is part of what I'm comfortable with. I'm comfortable with it, disposed in that, comfortable with it. That's why. And I've put in the tough work. I've you know, made the connections with this, and then, wow, I mean, that's a big connection to meet a great bodhisattva, you know? I mean, it's a big wow. It's like, okay, but because I put in so much work, I've met other great bodhisattvas, too. Jesus, Anandamayi, Ramana Maharshi, etc., right? Krishnamurti. He may not be quite as big of a bodhisattva as the others I mentioned, but he's getting there. He was definitely on the path of that, right? He was helping them out for sure. Jiddu Krishnamurti, yeah. He really was helping them out. And he rejected the spiritualized delay of theosophy, for instance. He refused to be the world teacher. They were promoting him as, and says, no, truth is a pathless land. And he went to non-dual. He witnessed for that. He really witnessed for that as best he could under the circumstances and the culture, etc., etc. So he rejected the esotericism of it all. I said, that's not it. It's not it. That's just spiritualized delay, really. And yet sometimes that approach might be used for those who are at a place where they want to super spiritualize their delay, which ultimately forces them into really good habits, which can then be flipped towards, you know, into the context of the direct approach. So, you know, this is a possibility. It's a possibility. This is why I say theosophy, that there's a possibility that it was a certain approach that was setting up the later flipping of the script into a direct approach. I mean, that's the best spin I can put upon it. And it could very well turn out to be that way. Or not, right? Or not. it's being charitable, but it's also being realistic, because this is possible. Just like, for instance, Christianity turned into, you know, a lot of pious self-righteousness and good habits and et cetera, which is, but these good habits of trying to spiritualize delay, again, can be transferred over to the direct approach. It's kind of like a musical instrument that you playing one musical instrument that can be transferred to another. For instance, like playing piano, which I was in a previous life a virtuoso piano player, and among other things. And then this life, I transferred that over to guitar. Well, it wasn't an easy transfer, but there was some transfer of habits. It did create some difficulty. It did. It's kind of like transfer like baseball swing to a golf swing. It's difficulty. But I've ultimately been able to kind of do it. Because there's still the discipline, the practice. A lot of stuff is similar. Okay. Of understanding how to practice, how to be disciplined, how to be patient for results. How to... there's a lot that can be transferred over. But the transferring has to take place. It has to ultimately take place. So we have to keep emphasizing that. And so we're not talking theosophy here, right? No, we're saying transfer those good habits that you have over to the direct approach and be vaccinated from smartness, or from the idea that we can create this holistic society of where smartness is used to enhance our life in so many ways, but we can spiritualize all of that. That's trying to make the house of delay a home. And quite frankly, some may not like to hear this, but quite frankly, it's important to point this out, that many women are involved in that right now in this world. Men too, but they're following the lead. Those taking the lead are women. Men are following that along with that. Because women, of course, are very good at making a house a home, that which is really okay, trying to spiritualize delay. They're very good at it. And this, we reached a crisis in the world now where we're trying to decide which way to go, and it seems the safer way, the way we're familiar with, is to make the house a home. So women are now in the lead in the world of spiritualizing this delay. So there's so many, many, many women who attend spiritual teachers and spiritual, as you go, it's like about 80-20, the ratio of women to men. Now you get invited to some spiritual event, you look into it, and you realize everyone who's all the pictures and everything is all women. It's like, because they're taking the lead, because they are very expert in making a house a home, dressing it up, ornamenting it, dressing it up. But this is not what is called for right now. This is not what is called for. We are called to recognize the inherent, all arising inherently, of all appearance and all decoration and all ornamentation, etc., is merely ornamentation of its own intrinsic spaciousness. And there is no totality seeking a greater totality. And the fear we have is continuity fear, and it's not intrinsic at all. And there's no necessity to this search whatsoever. So this is very different. So I do not fall into this category here. We do not fall into that of the spiritualizing delay at all. At all. So I don't get along with that. I do not get along with that. I don't go in that direction. It just happens that direction is being heavily led by women right now. So I have to say no to that. Absolutely not. It's not that I'm saying no to quote-unquote women or so, at all. It's the direction that they're leading us in. I say no, cannot go in that direction. But not all women are going in that direction. Some are taking the direct approach. Some are trying to take the direct approach. Absolutely. But have to be careful, because the women who are trying to spiritualize delay are trying to take over all spirituality in the world, and they can, you know, they can easily start tempting other women, saying, hey, come on, let's, you know, say, you want to, you know, you don't, let's have the sisterhood, let's all be going in the same direction here, let's not have conflict here. So they're under a lot of pressure. I think women who are trying to take their approach are under a terrible pressure, which is why I'm speaking up for them on their behalf, actually, and behalf of men, on behalf of everyone. But certainly I'm speaking up on the behalf of women who are trying to take the direct approach. This is the approach they're taking, and they're under this ungodly pressure to compromise, which is trying to make, again, graduated approach, spiritualize and delay. That quote-unquote compromise means spiritualize delay. That's what it really means. It's shorthand for spiritualize delay. There's no compromise between, there's not lies that are true. That's what they're saying. Well, let's settle for the true lies. You know, let's get rid of the lies, the lie lies, and let's settle for the true lies. There are no true lies. This is the delusion of the graduated approach of smartness. So I'm speaking out for all those women everywhere, in all time and space, who saying no to this, let's make this house a home, and saying, let's take this direct, I'm taking this direct approach, because this is what is right and this is what works. And speaking up for all men, because men really follow the lead of women. They really do. And this is the way that this dream is disposed. Certainly those who are trying to make a house a home, spiritualized delay, they follow the lead of women. They do. Sometimes women are out in front, overtly leading, and sometimes they're covertly leading by subtly manipulating. They're more covert. Right now, they're more overt. Okay, and the compromise, they're saying, let's blend the covertness and overtness, and then we'll have a perfect leadership style. If we can develop a perfect leadership style that perfectly leads us into, you know, into futility. And we can elect these perfect leaders that do what we want, who understand, you know, that doing what we want them to do with this perfect leadership management style. You know, you see it, it's amazing. These women are just amazing that are doing this. So misleading. I was watching a golf tournament. They brought in this human resources, CEO of human resources of this big, huge global corporation that's helping lead everyone into smartness. And one look at her, I said, oh, there's one right there. Look how sly she is, very sly. She's kind of looking at her like, I've got this perfect management balance of covert, overt. You know, I've managed to integrate my covert and overt leadershipness. Of spiritualizing gradualness, spiritualizing delay. And so she's talking out of both sides of her mouth, and everybody's, and like she's thinking in her mind, like, wow, I'm a real superstar. You know, I'm here on television telling everybody, showing everybody that what we do for kids is like wonderful. You know, I guess it's like, you know, there you go. This is what is here now. Is these so called power women who are now becoming CEOs and taking very strong over leadership positions in all global corporations, absolutely. And they specialize in spiritualizing delay. And this is called the New World Order. This is called the New World Order. Spiritualizing delay. We say we're going to have this wonderful world here, and we're all going to get what we finally want. We're finally going to feel like a home here. This is like really home for us here, you know. This dream of fear is like really home for us. Yeah, finally. Because we finally found the right management style. Okay, this is what is going on. And I have the courage to point it out here. I have the mandate to point it out. It, from the familiarity of the direct approach, mandates we speak up. Jesus says, don't hide your light under a bushel, right? Because this is, if you know, speak up. If you know, speak up. So others may hear this. So they believe that they've finally found this the right management style. It's a blend of overt and covert manipulation and leadership. That's what women, liberation movement, etc. Ultimately, now we see in hindsight, that's what it was really about. The cat's now out of the bag about that. I just didn't have the correct terminology to describe it real clearly to everybody. I knew what was going on, but I didn't know quite how to share this and explain it and clarify it to everyone. Now I do. So they can be vicious, they can be kind, they can be overt, they can be covert, you know, it's this blend. And they think because of this blend, they can, don't worry, they can do no wrong, they can't mislead us. It's impossible, they say. We finally got the right management style. Forget about the direction, the context, the purpose, and all this. It's the style, you know, the management style. They're trying to elect a president who has this just the right blend, you know. And we could chuckle at it because we're going to be free of that. And we're seeing it, and this delights us. It delights us to see this, actually. It really does. I hope there are many women viewing this and hearing this and who are taking the direct approach and saying, ah, thank you, that's great. Finally, there's someone who really sees this and can speak up about it, as we're having trouble. We're under so much pressure. It's certainly not meant to offend anyone who's taking the direct approach at all, male or female. Not in the slightest bit. I don't follow the news, but I'm certainly aware of just the basic spiritual dynamics of what is taking place. It's very blatant, very blatant, very obvious what's taking place. And, you know, don't get caught up in all this. We're going to be liberated from this. Don't follow the politics of this election. All politics is spiritual politics. Follow the clarity of the direct approach and be inoculated from all of this. This is what we should, how we should use our time. Maybe I should run as a candidate, as the anti-candidate, the non-candidate. Maybe I should declare my non-candidacy for all offices. And you can elect me as the an ideal non-candidate. And maybe I should start barnstorming as the non-candidate. This would be a genius move. I don't know if this is in the works from the Holy Spirit or not. Maybe. Can I do that? Everyone knows me, might disown me. I never knew him. Like Peter disowning Jesus. I never met him. Never gone with him. I have no idea what you're talking about. They're trying to elect the perfect candidate. How about electing the perfect, or not perfect, but ideal non-candidate, or elect a non-candidate, at least ragged but right non-candidate. And then from there, maybe you can elect an even better non-candidate. Maybe I'm in the primary of non-candidacy, and then you weed out and say, finally you say, well, I think Jesus would be is the perfect non-candidate, or I think Manjushri is the perfect non-candidate, or Buddha mind, perfect non-candidate, or something, right? Ultimately, Buddha, my vision of sameness is the perfect non-candidate. What's going on? I don't know what's going on here. Okay. See what's going on here. I don't know what's going on. I heard all these noises. Maybe that's a disagreement. Perfect non-candidate. All right, let's have a non-candidate primary. I'm entering the non-candidate primary. You're going to elect a non-candidate as your leader. Interesting. Have everyone involved in a non-candidacy. That'd be a nice divine, helpful distraction, would it not? Meet and greet with a non-candidate. Let's have a meet and greet with a non-candidate. I'll give my non-candidacy speech, reading from Longchenpa. Why not? I like this. This is an interesting idea. I don't know how pragmatic it is. Let's go out and play golf. Have a meet and greet and play golf. Engage in non-candidacy action. Everybody can give me non-money, donation, non-donation, blank checks. Everybody write me a blank check. Or no, well, don't write me a blank, just give me a blank check. There's nothing, no signature on it. Collect no money. Okay, all the donations of zero. Everyone is required to donate $0 to this effort. For the purpose of practicing, from a pragmatic standpoint, of course, there would need to be donations to move about. But from the practicing standpoint, everyone attending has to give a donation of 0 cents. It's a requirement. Have fundraisers. Everybody raising no funds. Yeah. Oh, you see, this is thinking outside the box of politics. Isn't this awesome? Thinking outside the box of politics here. I got my clothes I got my suits and clothes and stuff for the non-candidacy. Ready to go. Got my swing going. I gotta go practice my swing right now, as a matter of fact. Why should I, you know, gotta take it easy if you're a non-candidate, right? Gotta play golf every day if you're a non-candidate. Maybe I'm announcing my non-candidacy for president. Yeah. I'm officially announcing my non-candidacy for the president of the United States. My perfect non-candidacy. I have been filing absolutely nowhere. I've done all my non-filing. I've already done all my non-filing. This is like, okay, this is the new normal, thinking in this way. With all these bells are ringing, I hear, must be, what is it, noon or something? Yeah. High noon. It's high noon right now. Showdown. I might make a good non-candidate, at least in the primaries. I don't know if I'll be the ultimate one, but maybe I can throw my hat in the ring. Throw my golf hat in the ring. I mean, we need a robust primary season, don't we not? Do we not? And what could people say? You're crazy. You can't not run for president. You can't not run. What do you mean I can't not run? Everybody's not running, aren't they? I'm just saying I'm a really great non-candidate. Ideal non-candidate. Ideal non-runner for president. So this is something that people might want to elect, because I could say we like this leader better than the one you're trying to elect as a runner for president. We got a non-runner for president. You got a candidate, we got a non-candidate. You got a president, we got a non-president. You know, we like that leadership better. Maybe they like that leadership better. See, this is sort of parting the way of diverging of the two, of smartness and grace. You know, smartness and grace. One tries to says we can spiritualize delay. That solves the problem. The other says we need to get spiritual practice going, so evaporate the continuity fear, and then you'll realize that everything is indeed arises spontaneously, arises intrinsically without any effort, not straying one iota from its own spaciousness. It's just mere decoration of its intrinsic spaciousness. That's it. That's it. And there's no mandate to seek a greater totality than totality. All there is intrinsically. All there is now. So two different directions here. One has this candidate leading, other has the non-candidate leading, right? Right. I don't know. We'll see where this goes. I mean, it's like a bee in my bonnet, you know? It's not impossible I could do it. Really. Or maybe it is. I don't know. Maybe it'd be too stressful. People look at you like, that's too far outside of the box. probably, you know, I need the place of golf though to get away from it, the pressure. Gotta get away from the pressure. So, yeah, gotta at least appear to be, you know, some similarity to candidates. Although they're not playing golf now. They're frozen. Money, 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 money. I need to get more money. I need billions. Come on. I know the right management style. I got the right management style. I'm blending the covert and the overt. I am woman. Hear me roar. I got the right management style. I am, you know, I'm going to make this house a home. If it's the last thing to do, I'm going to, if I have to break some eggs and make an omelet, I'm going to do it. But I'll do it the right management style way. So it'll be all effective. Don't worry. Smile. Give me money. Give me more. Give me millions. You, more millions. How much is enough for these candies? There's no amount is enough. Is enough. But they say, adore my management style. It doesn't my management style adorable? On one hand, I absolutely bust heads. On the other hand, I'm a smiling, nice lady and charming. This is what the world of candidates is getting, right? I mean, it's going to be one or the other of these knuckleheads, really, right? I think what we need is a non-candidate. I know what we need is a non-candidate. But who's going to be our non-candidate? Come on, I'm looking for a non-candidate, please. Will the non-candidate please show up so we can support them in this primary season? Now, in their enthusiasm, people might get a little wacky with that. You see, there's a problem. Maybe back in the 60s, you know, the hippie thing. But it was, you know, it was interesting. The guy was a little ragged. It was a little ragged. Because they get a little over-enthusiastic and don't realize that this is serious business. It's super serious business, non-candidacy. And yet it's inspired business, too. It's both. It's both serious and inspired. So if you can blend those two of seriousness and inspiration, then you'd be a good non-candidate. I'm laughing, but I'm seriously considering it. This is quite nice inspiration that has flown in the window today. How we doing on this one? Moving right along. Oh, okay. Very good. This turned out better than I expected. You know, I was going to read this book straight through, which I did before, but I did such a great job before. I said, let that video just stand on its own. And so I just did this one. I did a couple of takes, which is I rarely do. I said, no, that's not it. No, that's not it. I don't feel right. And so eventually I used it to morph into this, you know, I used it as a boost to bring this idea up. Wow. Because I find that, like, especially Americans are such political animals, they can't seem to divorce themselves from it. So maybe we need it has to be put in a political context, help has to be put in some sort of political context. Now, I can certainly give a speech, right? Yeah. Well, I don't know. I could give a speech to nobody. I'm very good at that. Giving a non-speech. I'm very good at giving a non-speech. I can be silent too and give a very good non-speech. Maybe that's what people like right now. I want to go hear a non-candidate give a non-speech. Is not running for office. But there's still similarity to the politics, right? Politics, 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 politics. Maybe there can be a news network, an ad hoc, that people, you know, create their own news network of following the non-candidacy. Where's our non-candidate? Please, I think we need one in the United States, a non-candidate. So this is inspired. At least it's an inspired idea, isn't it? Maybe you play with that idea. Maybe you're the ideal non-candidate. Maybe not. I think you have to have some, you know, you have to have the right stuff in some way. But you can play with the idea. Like, hey, what would it be like to be a non-candidate? Giving non-speeches. Right? Non-events. It's a non-political, non-event of a non-candidate giving a non-speech. And yet the trappings are still there. Why not have some trappings? Put up the bunting. Yeah, red, white, and blue bunting. Actually, I have red, white, and blue on right now, don't I? Maybe that means I am the non-candidate. Oh my gosh. I got the blue here. I got the white. I got the blue. And I got the red, and then I got the white, and I got the white, and so red, white, blue, red, white, blue, red, white, blue. There's the bunting right here. I'm wearing the bunting. Maybe I've been outed as the perfect non-candidate. Outed myself. Maybe I've outed myself. I don't know. I'm finally out of the closet. Yes, I am actually the perfect non-candidate who's not running. As your non-candidate, this is what I'll lead you to. I'll lead you to the direct approach. I'll say, let's try it now, and then experience the continuity fear, then say, wow, I did it in spite of the continuity. We're saying, no, 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 no. in spite of smartness, saying, no, 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 you can't do that. In spite of big mother, goddess mother, saying, no, 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 I'll make this house a home. Don't you worry, my son. My child, don't worry. The millennium is coming where everything will be comfortable. We'll have so many, will be such ease and comfort, material goods, and everything will be distributed nicely, and we'll have this wonderful socialism everywhere, where there's every perfect distribution, and peace will reign. We'll be so happy in this home. What, you don't need to make that direct approach. That just threatens the whole thing. It's destabilizing. Come on. Come on, my child, don't do that. I did it anyway. Despite of the objections of the ego, I overruled the objections of the ego. Wow. I'm really the boss, huh? That is really something. I'm sure there are a lot of people that would prefer that, really. But they say, ah, oh, there's no non-candidate to support. You know, who can we support? How about a non-candidate that speaks of a very different outcome, right? Than being living in, you know, artificial intelligence fascism land. Well, we'll see what the Holy Spirit will do. Buddhist tradition, they might call it. We'll see what the Bodhisattvas will do. Manjushri, etc. Yeah, we'll see. They kind of categorize it a little more. The Christianity just says it's the Holy Spirit. Very abstract, I like that. But it doesn't mean I don't like the Bodhisattva way of looking at it too. It's the same, it's just there's a little more categorizing in Buddhism than in Christianity, tends to be a little more. And, you know, the problem with Christianity is so abstract that a lot of people have a lot of trouble with it. Right? And they want some more categorizing. So you might say Buddhism has some pragmatism to it, and it does do that categorizing. But the downside is you can overdo that also. So it's six of one, half a dozen of the other, really. Between Buddhism and Christianity, it's six of one, half a dozen of the other. It's tomato, tomato. Both have upside and both have some downside in terms of, right? I mean, you have to approach it properly either way you go. Same with all, whatever tradition you're talking about. Wow, that's a cold wind that's coming in. Wow. This is the last blast of this, of these wet systems that have been coming in. Supposed to warm up. We'll see. They've been getting it so wrong, but they do say huge, you know, big high pressure system coming in, warming up here, cooling down, cooling off in the south right now. Right, y'all having this blizzard. Yeah, it's just, you know, it's a blizzard. Oh, okay. And then first in February, first half of February, we're supposed to get cooler weather here, cooler, wetter weather in the east and south, supposed to get warmer weather. So that's flip-flopping around. Maybe I can get out and play golf as a non-candidate. Maybe. Oh my gosh. That's interesting. I'll just let it marinate. Just see what happens next. If I don't run as a candidate, I'm waiting for something coming today from FedEx. I'm waiting for something. Very nice. It's a Holy Spirit bag tag. Yeah. Had it custom made. Maybe that's my candidacy right there. I'm running as the Holy Spirit candidate. The Holy Spirit non-candidate for to be non-president of the United States. Of the world. It looks like the United States. Oh, here comes FedEx stopping right here. I wonder if this is it. let us see, folks, if this is a FedEx man, a FedEx person, maybe coming up here with a Holy Spirit bag tag. If it is, I will show it to you. You'll be the first to see it. And maybe it's for some other house, though. You know, it's possible. Let me see. I will go up and greet them if they're coming this way. Or it might be something else. I don't know. It could be something else, too. Oh, here he comes. Okay, awesome. Here he comes. It is it, folks, and the FedEx man delivered it directly to me. He saw me taping it. He said, okay, quiet, he's quiet. And he handed it to me. He's like, here you go. He's like, okay. Wow, this is it. This is it. This is it. This is the Holy Spirit bag tag. Wow, this is exciting, folks. This is really exciting. Oh, wow. This is really cool. Wow, this is really cool. This is the receipt, and this is the package that it's coming in. So we're going to open this up. Let me bring down the contrast on this. It's too much. Wow, that's a little too much. I brought down a little too much here. Okay, so let me bring down the brightness on this so you can see this a little better. This is very exciting. This is happening in real time. You're viewing what is going on. Wow. Okay. Let's see if... what side is this side is a little okay. So we're going to open this package up here. Wow. This I'm and we're going to take it out right here on camera. Wow. That is awesome indeed, folks. It's really a luggage tag, but I'm going to use it. It's a very nice one, actually. I'm going to use it as a golf tag and golf bag or whatever. And we can't really see. I'm going to have to back off the contrast. I'm back off on this to see. I'm going to have to darken this, okay? So you can see clearly, more clear. Let me see. There you go. There you go. That is the tag that I got. Now, it's really supposed to be it's the ascent of the Holy Spirit, which would go like this. Okay. Or, yeah, the ascent of the Holy Spirit, like this. It's a very strong luggage tag. Now, on the bag, it will go like this. So, what this reflects is this, we're still going horizontally for a while. Okay, we're still going horizontally for a while here before we ascend. Okay. Wow. I should put this around my... Let me put this... how can I put this in around something on my... not really sure how to do that. But it's got a clip on it. It's very strong. It's very interesting. It's very strong. Wow. So this is really exciting. Really exciting here. This is truly exciting. Maybe this is announcing my non-candidacy. It's a way to announce my non-candidacy. I mean, that's just this. Wow. I had this custom made. I searched for it online. I couldn't find any golf tags for the Holy Spirit. I could not find for my golf bag. I was shocked. I said, well, this is terrible. So I finally had it made, custom made for me. Wow. Let me see. Does this open up in any way? Is there any opening here? Does this open up? No, not really. Okay, so there's not. Like, this doesn't go around the neck, but where would it go around? It would go... You could loop it... Oh, you can loop it through your pants loop, can't you? By making a loop like that. Interesting. Yeah. Okay. Because you could loop it around like this and then put it through like this and then, yeah. Very nice. Wow. Holy cow. I see. That's a very nice bag tag. Thank you. Thank you so much, Cafe Press. Thank you so much for that. Really. That's awesome. Great job. Great job. Much appreciated. The non-candidate has much appreciation for that. We all do. Everyone who supports the non-candidacy. Gosh. And thank you, FedEx. UPS, FedEx. Yeah, they do a good job what they do for sure. What's that? Okay. Alright, well, we've had a lot of nice intensity here in this video, haven't we? We've a couple of hours. Those of you that are still with this, you might be, you know, warming up, saying, hey, maybe things are a little better than we thought. Maybe that's a little better than we thought. Maybe this is the new counterculture right here. Not even that. This is the new inspirational culture. It's not counterculture, it's inspirational culture. The new inspirational culture. The non-candidacy culture. Maybe it's the non-candidacy culture. You can call that, yeah. NCs, or the NCs. The NCs, the non-candidate culture. Not the hippies, the NCs. In the rallies, you get a spiritual talk, you see? That's the benefit, isn't it? You can go to these non-candidate rallies and get a... This is very cool. I'm going to just see how it goes. And you know, the ideas now come out into consciousness here. And then it starts to... Let's see how it gains momentum. See how this idea gains momentum. Well, I won't struggle with that. I'll just stay in the wow of it. Stay in the wow of it. Put this bag tag on next. And, wow. Full stop in the wow. Maybe we'll just have full stop in the wow events. Yeah. So everybody says, wow, and I met them on now. And I met the non-candidate. Wow. What do? I just sit full stop in the wow. That's what we do. And it's true, right? I mean, we have this inspired humor about it. We're delighted. We laugh because we're delighted. It's a laugh of delightment, actually. I'm delighted. Absolutely delighted about this. I'm still waiting for one more package. This is a very slow package. It's just taken forever to get here. A terrible service in that way. I ordered the same piece of clothing from another vendor. It was there the next day. This one... It's been like, you know, 2 weeks, almost 2.5 weeks. It still hasn't gotten here. And it's just, but, you know, maybe it's waiting for my non-candidacy to arrive. Probably. All right, delight. We're delighted. We're delighted to be a non-candidate. You're absolutely delighted to not be here, to support the non-candidacy. You know, our smartness is not here. We're delighted to be without our smartness as we support this non-candidate in spiritual grace and inspiration. with the help of the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, all the bodhisattvas, all the avatars, the sages, the gurus, the saints, and the great ones of all traditions, the ones who have been liberated from the idea of the necessity of a search, who are abiding in the totality, the one totality. We welcome all their support and their guidance and inspiration. And we're pulling out all the stops now. We're pulling out all the stops. Very great. All right, I'm going to put that on my golf bag. And then stay tuned, stay tuned, stay tuned, stay tuned, stay tuned. We'll see what happens. What's the next unfoldment? How this flower unfolds. There's this flower blossoming right now, and we don't know what it's going to look like as it unfolds. Right? It's like it's the bud has been tight and covered with and now it's starting to burst open and unfold. And we just said, what is this flower going to look like? Well, stay tuned, and we will experience that. Very great. That's it for this one. Holy Spirit. All blessings of the Holy Spirit and all the bodhisattvas upon everyone. Always.